get him.
This is the Badlands in South Dakota.
What year is it?
This is July 6th, 1990.
Where are we going?
Where are we going, Tony? We're driving to Seattle. Tony will be there if he makes it.
Oh, here we are in the Badlands, and here's a picture of a bad guy with a bad car.
We're on our way to Hawaii.
We're driving to Hawaii, right, Beth?
Yep.
Look at the road, guys. Okay, you see how close we're going on.
Thanks, Tom.
Thank you. Dad, do you think we could
play? Yeah, 10, 10, 10.
We're still in Wyoming, coming upon Sheridan, Wyoming. These are the Bighorn Mountains. Anthony. Hi, Tom. Tony, do you love me in Montana?
Yellowstone Park. Yellowstone Park. 1990, Yellowstone Park.
Hey Ryan, what are you? Ryan, what are you? Thank you.
a shark. Sharks are way bigger.
Oh, look at that little shark.
It's not a shark.
Fish.
What kind of a fish?
I don't know.
Sharks in here.
Yeah, there was one.
Two black tip reef sharks.
What's your say?
Two black tip reef.
Yep.
There is.
There's one and there's another one that's special.
So you've got right up there.
Oh, there's one up top.
That's their area that they have. They claim the top part of the tank.
Do they get larger?
They will get up to 6 feet, but the aquarium doesn't let them get that big. They'll trade them or they'll release them. They tend to let them
get
only
up, they get
keep
them
up
good
3 4
that way.
There he goes again.
Who picked that up?
They're putting coral back in their places.
What is the coral there? Coral in your life form?
No, I can't keep it because I can't really feed it.
Oh, there comes a shark.
There might be some parts that are.
That's it. Oh, why did they always go into that corner?
Yeah, it does, Mom. It does.
Oh, yeah.
Paul, see, then, can you see that? Can you see this one?
Right. Turns into a big ball. Huh?
There's a shark! There's a shark!
Yeah.
Well, now we're going to get a good one.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I'm going that way.
There's a guy going this way.
I see a shark. Is that a shark?
Yeah, you're going to see a lot of them back here because the sharks follow each other. Most of the sharks.
Look at that. Look at those colors.
He's moving like a dead man. Yeah.
He's dancing to that music.
He is.
Pick it up, man.
Pick it up?
Sure.
Can you pick these crabs up?
Yeah, you can pick just about everything up.
Ooh, that's just so cool. Can you pick this up?
Oh, look, there's no back in there.
Yep. You want to see a little one or a big one?
Oh, a big one.
Big one, huh? I figured. Everybody likes the big one.
Oh, wow.
Oh, my gosh.
That
is
so big.
Oh.
Oh.
Look at its feet, turn it over.
Oh, cool.
That's weird.
It's leaking.
Look, it's collapsing, see?
It's leaking.
Oh,
I
know.
Oh, that's cool.
This little crab.
There's the
yeah. Oh, whoa, that's huge. I see the two. That white shell that's rolling around in there. The crab's on it.
Look at that, a big starfish.
She's going to get another one.
See this crab?
Look at that big star.
I wish he stole somebody's old shell to live in. Such crazy to somebody's old shell.
Yeah, this is
and there's a big
star.
That is a big
star. It
stays
cold all
day. Wow. You want to touch him?
Touch him.
Oh, he's very soft.
Want to touch him? No, there used to be some more babies. Just be so strong. It's hard. A minute ago, it was stuck there.
Oh, look at this guy. He's sticking to the bottom. Why is he sticking to the bottom?
They stick to the bottom. It's called
a tiger. Look at that. Holy cow.
Oh. They stick to the bottom. So it's a mollusk.
Do you want to hold
him?
No, that's okay.
I want to hold him.
Ryan will hold him.
Okay. Ryan, you got to hold him by the shell, okay?
Go ahead. Stand up on the bench.
Suck. I got to get him under here.
No, he'll get him. He can reach down in there and get his hands.
But he sticks to the bottom. It's hard to get off. Pick him up, Ryan, by the shell.
Want to do it for yourself?
Oh, he's grabbing me.
Here, here.
Oh, go ahead.
Okay, grab him by the shovel how I was doing, okay?
Thank you. Here we This is a salmon run on the outside of the Seattle Aquarium. That's where it starts.
Repaired often enough, the piers just simply fall apart. They eventually have to be torn down. Pier 58, for instance, was Pier 58. Seattleites went nuts. This ship had a very unusual cargo on board. It had 1 ton of gold on board. Even Seattle's mayor at that time disappeared. Well, we later found out that he hopped on a ship for Alaska to look for gold himself. We haven't heard from him since. This is the beginning of the Great Alaskan Klondike Gold Rush. At that time, tens of thousands of people came to Seattle on their way to Alaska to look for gold. And, well, Seattle became instantly known as the gateway to Alaska. Here on the north side of Pier 59, just around the corner there, back over your right shoulder, you can see the Seattle Marine Aquarium. Very educational aquarium that has a great variety of sea life from Puget Sound and some from Alaska and from tropical areas. We have a number of studies going on here. Right now we're cruising by the Edgewater Inn. This hotel was completed in 1962, just in time for the opening of the 62 World's Fair. Back then, this was known as the only hotel in the world where you could fish in your bedroom window. One time even had fishing gear available down the front deck. 127 feet long, and the cruise at over 30 knots. Makes the trip up to Victoria in just 2.5 hours. So this is the boat you want to take up to Victoria if you just want to spend a day. Well, get up there early, and then come back and stay in the evening. Pier 59, by the way, for many years was owned by a Canadian company based out of Toronto. For about a decade, they owned the pier. And just recently, the Port of Seattle was able to get it back. And even the port doesn't know what they're going to do with it yet. They may move their main headquarters on here. But Pier 70 was originally known as the Ainsworth of Dunwoody. This was the first pier built in Seattle. And this is where he first imported silk from Asia by the turn of the century. That's a great view of the Seattle Space Needle from here. Situated on the Seattle Center Ground, which was, of course, the fairground at one time for the 1962 World's Fair. The Space Needle stands 607 feet, has two main decks on top. An observation deck, and I just throw that as a restaurant, which spins around and makes one revolution per hour. At one time, you were able to go up to the observation deck and just lean over the side and straight down, something really taking you back. Seattle standards, very hilly city. Coming up here is Queen Anne Hill. probably have, say, six major hills in the Seattle area. But at one time, you know, there was a hill that stood right where the Space Hill is today, and it went all the way back down to past Virginia Street. That was Denny Hill. Well, it was flattened out for a couple of good stretches out about a mile up and down the shoreline. This is called Myrtle Edwards Waterfront Park. Transported inland from here. About 80% of all the cargo that's dropped off in Seattle will be leaving this port and be transported across the United States. 90% of all the cargo that's dropped off here is from Pacific Asia. We import mostly consumer goods, a lot of clothing, and a lot of electronics like cameras, stereos, computers, things like that. And you'll find Seattle's exports to be raw goods, a lot of paper products, cotton, and animal hides. Those are 378 feet long. They have gas turbine engines that cruise at 29 knots. They also have diesel engines for long-range cruising. And here we have one of them on the side of the pier. These ships have helicopters and hospital facilities on board. They're often used in search and rescue missions. They have a great variety of armaments. More modern armaments are being installed now. And they often work in conjunction with the Drug Enforcement Agency, who will give them any tips on succeeding in running down and capturing drug smugglers. These ships also patrol the 200-mile fishing limit off the coast. One of the biggest problems I think we have in our ocean are long drift nets. Nets which stretch out for miles and are... Well, this is a barracks ship, and this is just a temporary home for many of the crew of the USS Chandler. Might not look that hot from the outside, but at least it has a basketball court on the top deck. The USS Chandler is here for an entire year for refurbishing. The ship is 563 feet long, and this is a guided missile destroyer. This is the most powerful and fastest class of destroyer of the United States Navy. The ship is powered by four GE gas turbine engines. It has 80,000 shaft horsepower, and the ship can cruise up to about 40 knots. Top speed is classified. Ship is used in both anti-air and anti-submarine warfare. Just on the other side of the Navy ship, we have a couple of dry docks. You might want to notice the Emerald Sea. This dry dock is much larger than it looks. If you would take the dry dock out, put it up on its end in our skyline, it would be the second tallest structure in the skyline. Here we have a large ship. Inside, doesn't even take up half of it. This is the Polar Star, a very impressive ship built in Seattle by Lockheed and completed in 1976. here it is. Polar Star and its identical sister ship are based out of Seattle. They work mostly in the Arctic and Antarctica in oceanographic research. Most powerful non-nuclear icebreaker in the world. It has a cruising range of 28,000 miles and is capable of circumnavigating the globe on just one load of fuel. Now the ship has a very unique hull design and it's designed to ram the ice, pick up little speed and ram the ice, and then it will hit the ice and squeeze up on top, like squeezing a seat between your thumb and your forefinger, and then it slides across the ice like a ski or a sled, eventually crushing back through at their sheer weight. By doing so, they can go through almost 30 feet of ice. It has three propellers. They're made out of tungsten steel, very strong steel. They can chop right through the hard ice, so not to worry about them breaking up or chipping or bending. And here's the Great Land, this large ship. Carries containers, but also carries the trucks that tow the containers. It is driver ride on board. The Great Land operates between Tacoma and Alaska ports. One of the faster ships operating in Puget Sound. I hear it on the radio occasionally on Channel 14, which is for the vessel traffic system, and it's often reporting 21 knots. I'm not sure why it's here, what kind of work it's being done to it. Haven't heard yet. Here we have some more of the high endurance cutters, though, and the number 719 is the Boutwell, one of two cutters based out of Seattle. You may have noticed that they use oil container booms here, yellow and black booms in the water. These are just used as a precautionary measure. Just in case there was an accident, it's still oil, it will be contained. Have a chance to spread in the harbor, and they clean it up quick enough, so hopefully they won't be in danger to the marine environment. Luckily, we have laws forbidding any super tankers or any heavier dark oil on Puget Sound. These waters are not, Puget Sound is not capable of flushing itself out, so if there was a spill here, it would be a major disaster. And the Defender, which is just in front of it. These are a couple of the most powerful tugboats working in these waters. They have more horsepower than any of our Washington State ferries. They also have a fuel capacity of 210,000 gallons. These are known as the Red Stack fleet, and they became